Hello, everyone, and welcome to another episode of The Long and Winding Royal Road here at postwrestling.com. Of course, The Long and Winding Royal Road is our look back at the greatest period of professional wrestling ever in any part of the world, All Japan Pro Wrestling of the 90s. And this is episode 16, and as most of you who are regular listeners will know, every fourth episode we do a biography episode about one of the four pillars. And we of course started with episode 4 about Mitsuharu Misawa. We did episode 8 on Toshiaki Kawada. We did episode 12 on Ken Kobashi. So of course this brings us to episode 16, which is featuring of course the fourth pillar, but not the least pillar. Like a lot of people like say he's the least pillar. I think he's equally as good as the other four. I have that opinion. Maybe my guest has that opinion as well. We'll find out. But we're going to talk about Akira Taue, the man known as Dynamic T. And joining me today is a well-known Akira Taue Dynamic T aficionado, Dave Musgrave. Dave, how are you today?
I'm doing fantastic. And how are you?
I'm pretty good. As we were recording this, it's a nice evening. I had dinner and we're going to talk about a very underrated wrestler, in my opinion, that I have a lot of affection for. And from my understanding, you have a lot of affection for Akira Taue.
I do. And I would concur with you that he's as good as the other three pillars. And even I actually know some people who say he's the best of the four. I don't know if that's the case. That's kind of picking your favorite of your top four meals, I guess. I don't know. It's just they're all so great. But people who don't think he's as great as the other ones, I think he. I very much call him the Ringo Starr of All Japan, because he just happens to be surrounded by wrestling's equivalent of George Harrison, John Lennon, and Paul McCartney. And it's hard to measure up to them in some ways, but he holds his own. And the whole dynamic of the four of them, including their tag matches and the triple crown matches, would not be the same without this man.
No, I think for me, when I first started watching, you know, All Japan Pro Wrestling of this era, like for me, it was very hard for me to like get Taue. Like I'll confess, like I didn't immediately think, oh my god, he's so amazing. I was like, who the fuck is this guy? What, why is he with these other three guys? Like Taue, why is Taue in there with Kobashi, Misawa, and Kawada? But as years go by and I kind of like, you know, kind of get granular with watching these matches, I'm like, oh my god, there is something to him. And I always thought, okay, he's getting a push, he's in the position that he is with the other three is because he's like Giant Baba, the promoter of All Japan, looks at him and thinks, this is the wrestler that most resembles me of these four. So I'm going to give him a push. And I think there is some credence to that, even to this day. But I do think, like, you know, Baba and everyone actually probably who worked with Taue thought, this guy, he has these intangibles that we can't, you know, like we can't really, you know, put our finger on necessarily in terms of like his style. There's a lot of things where he just enhances the other three whenever he's facing them in singles matches or in the multitude of tag matches that he has first with, you know, Jumbo Tsuruta, but then later on in the Holy Demon Army with Toshiaki Kawada, by the way, which is the greatest tag team of all time. I don't care what anyone else says about like two, you know, DX cosplayers out there, you know, they're not as good as the Holy Demon Army.
I would agree. I've always been a big fan of Stan Hansen, Terry Gordy as a team, but they've got more longevity and yeah, they're it.
Like for me, my, you know, Holy Demon Army is the top team in All Japan of that period. And probably in my top three tag teams of all time. Then it's like Burning. I'm a huge fan of the team of Kobashi and Akiyama. And then I'd say like Misawa Kawada, and then Misawa Kobashi is like number four in the All Japan rankings for tag teams for me.
Of the 90s.
Of the 90s, yeah.
And one of the thought exercises I find really helpful with Taue as well is, if it wasn't him in the four pillars, who was it going to be? Like, and there's no one who matches up. The closest I could think of is if Fuyuki had stuck around. Like, he might have been an interesting dynamic as a fourth pillar, because a lot of people thought he was the better member of Footloose, at least during that time. But I don't think he would have. I don't think he would have lived up to Tawei. Tawei brought a dynamic. I know Samoa Joe and CM Punk. I saw a shoot interview with them years ago, and they were talking about, you can't be the two exact same wrestlers. You are only as big in comparison to someone else who's small. You were only scientific in comparison to someone else who's a brawler. And you need those kind of different dynamics in there opposing each other.
I mean, as far as a fourth pillar goes, like, you could maybe make an argument for Tsuyoshi Kikuchi, but I mean, he was a junior. He was a great tag wrestler, but I don't think he would have had the intimidation factor that Tawei had, because Tawei was actually a very tall wrestler compared to a lot of the other wrestlers in All Japan. Like, his physique is not the greatest, but that's not where the intimidation comes from him. It's really like his demeanor and like this mean streak that he develops, particularly during his time with Jumbo Tsuruta. But, you know, Dave, I don't want to get too ahead of ourselves. We want to get some background on Tawei, but also we want to get some background on you for the listeners, like, you know, kind of your credentials as to why are you on the long and winding Royal Road talking about Akira Tawei. So give us a little bit of background on Dave Musgrave, please.
So I have been a fan since 1986. I'm 46 now, just to make clear in case anyone wanted to do math. So I've been a fan for 35 years, and I've done a lot of writing for The Observer over the years, some for Slam Wrestling, some for Place to Be Nation. I had the Wrestling Culture podcast with my friend Dylan Hales for a few years, and that was a lot of fun. That's probably what most people would know me for. And essentially what we would do is we pick a topic, sometimes a wrestler, sometimes do a biography episode, and just obsessively research it and talk it to death and have a lot of fun doing it, and make... I'll try to keep the inappropriate jokes to a minimum on this show, but we didn't on that show.
So, I see. Okay.
Yeah. We had a lot of fun, and that's what most people know me for. I also, like, some people that I'm known for writing on would be Mike and Ben Sharp. I did a match list of Akira Tawei when he first went back on the Hall of Fame ballot for the Wrestling Observer. That's the kind of stuff I like to pull together. I guess to describe the obsessiveness I go into that with, it's just, I picture the look on my mother-in-law's face when I told her that I'll pick a wrestler, find every match I can of them online, make a Word doc listing every one of them, close it, never look at it again. The journey is the fun.
I can appreciate that kind of, you know, kind of work ethic and OCD, you know, aspect of it as well. Like, you know, like I can be like that about certain topics as well. But well Dave, I'm excited. This is my first time talking with you and podcasting with you, so let's get into Akira Tawei Dynamic T. So he's born on May 8th, 1961. He's the eldest son of a construction worker from Chichibu, Saitama, which is outside of Tokyo. You know, as a teenager, Tawei was quite active in various sports, such as the high jump, the shot put, baseball, and judo, which is kind of funny, because later on we're gonna kind of go into like how he is infamously known for hating training.
Oh, that's interesting. That's a factoid I didn't know.
Oh, you don't know like that he hates training?
No.
Oh, well, there you go. Like, so I guess he as a teenager, man after
my own heart. Yeah.
As a teenager, he was a lot more like into like, I'm gonna play all these sports. I'm gonna go to practice. I'm gonna go like exercise. But as he got older, maybe after his time in sumo, he was like, I don't want to train. Ah, oh, what? So we'll talk. I'll talk about a couple of stories I was able to find about his hatred of training a little later on. But after graduating junior high school, Tawei would find work as a part-time auto mechanic, and he would attend the Saitama Prefectural Chichibu High School. And it was in high school that he would get involved with the traditional Japanese sport of sumo, and he would join his high school's club as a sophomore. And then he would find a modicum of success as a sumo wrestler in high school by winning third place in the National Sumo High School Championship. And it's after high school that he goes into his college's sumo club, And I guess this is where you're a big sumo fan, Dave. So let's talk about Akira Taue's time in sumo wrestling. And I guess kind of like, we'll start with the stable that he joins. As I see in my notes here, he joins the Oshiogawa stable during his third year and makes his pro sumo wrestling debut in January of 1980.
Yeah. One thing that some people might not know is just how much the Japanese pro wrestling scene is set off of sumo. And that really comes from Ricky Dozan having come out of sumo. The whole dojo system is very similar. So he would have gone through a stable. They call it a Heya, H-E-Y-A. And he would have been a part of that. I'm not sure who he trained with there, who some of his contemporaries were. But basically making his pro debut in January 1980, that would have been basically as soon as he was starting training, pretty much. And when they have a sumo tournament, they have them six times a year. And basically early in the day, they'll start with the very earliest division, which is the very beginners. And they'll go right through, I think it's like nine divisions through to the top. And have the right through to the two the Yokozuna fighting each other, or whoever the Yokozuna are fighting at the end. So if you were really obsessive, you could watch a lot of sumo in one day for 15 days in a row. So he basically, there's a number of divisions, and there's two top divisions. They're the salary division. The first one is Juryo, and then it's followed by Makuuchi. And Makuuchi is the most famous one, where you would have a Yokozuna. To give you an idea of how far Taue progressed in sumo, he made it as far as Juryo. So he didn't get to the top division. So it'd be kind of like a wrestling equivalent of getting to NXT, but never making it to the main roster. But he was in the salaried ranks. I think even if you've been Juryo, you can be a trainer as well in some of the stables. So he did pretty well. Like they called him Sekitori once you're in those ranks and you're a salaried wrestler. And ideally, you get up to Makuuchi. To give you an example, Genichai Otenru did manage to get into Makuuchi and was pretty high up in that division, but didn't get into the championship ranks. A lot of the guys you hear of more recently, Ryota Hama, Kazusada Higuchi, those guys never made it as far as Taue did.
Right, our most famous pro wrestling example of a sumo wrestler achieving great success in sumo would be like Akibono.
Yes, Akibono he's the Brock Lesnar of the sumo to pro wrestling trend, I would say, because actually, no, that's Brock Lesnar had box office success, but he didn't have the success in MMA that Akibono did. Very few people have. And yeah. That's what's interesting with Taue as well is, you would look at him, think he's a big guy. If you don't know much about sumo, you might think that's a big advantage, but his height is actually a disadvantage because it's a center of gravity. So he left at a fairly young age, and that might have been part of the reason. He apparently also had a falling out with the head of his stable, which is a lot of the stories you hear. He probably took a cane, got caned one time or more in his time at that stable, and decided to leave for the relatively sane world of pro wrestling.
So from 1980 to 1986, Taue used his real name until he was promoted to the rank of Juryo, as you were saying, in May of 1986. He was then given the ring name or the shikona of Tamakirin Yasumasa. So he finds some success under that ring name. It's kind of funny, like that, you know, in sumo wrestling, they are given like gimmick names as well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And one of those two names is pretty much what he would have wrestled under. It's kind of the full name is your official name, but I think it would have been Tamakirin that he went, that he wrestled under when he would be announced.
Right. Like a lot of the sumo user, like just the first part, and they're more famous for just, you know, a single name. It's kind of like, you know, what Vince McMahon wants to do. This wrestler is now just called Bob.
Yes, and it works horribly in pro wrestling, but
it does. Yes.
It works pretty well in sumo.
Sound cool. These names actually sound cool. They probably have meaning to them. Whereas, like, what's Bob mean? It means well, I don't know what the fuck Bob means. It just means Bob, right? It's short form for Robert. There you go.
And speaking of this era, someone else who was really successful in sumo that made the transition was Hiroshi Ujima. And that's someone who just went by Ujima, which is his real last name. So,
well, there you go. So he, Taue competed in the Juryo division for, I believe, 7 tournaments before retiring from sumo in July of 1987. And Dave, if I'm getting any facts wrong, please feel free to correct me here. But yeah, like how would you say, like, so you're basically saying that Juryo, like you said, is the equivalent of like NXT. He never made it to the main roster. Do you think, you know, like his time in sumo, like the training in the dojo system of sumo, helps him become a pro wrestler, like in going through the All Japan dojo?
Absolutely. I think, the pro wrestler dojos are very much set up on sumo dojos because they were the same mindset that went into them. Right down to, you know, you have the young boys doing the chores for the senior wrestlers. That's very much right out of sumo. And actually, when you become a sekitori, which is when you enter juryo, that's when you no longer have to do that. So that's the level he made it to.
Yeah, I'm sure he was excited to wash, you know, Baba's body after the matches and towel him down and go get Stan Hansen's shoes and get all the beer
totally
for
get Stan Hansen's shoes.
But. Yeah, but maybe he didn't want to do that. Who knows?
No.
we don't know, you know. So so he leaves sumo in July of 87. And then in 1987, he's recommended thinking, what do I do with my life? I don't want to, I'm not going to be a sumo anymore. And then he meets a famous Japanese comedian, what they call a Rakugo storyteller, which is kind of like, a comedian who tells a story and then tells a long story and there's a punchline. This is a very popular form of comedy over in Japan. I've never had the chance to see it myself, but I'm familiar with I'd flip through television and be like, oh, it's a Rakugo storyteller. Oh, they're telling, the story. I'm not really following it too much. It's very nuanced. You have to really be well-versed, not only the language, but the culture of Japan to really get this type of comedy. But there's this Rakugo storyteller by the name of Sanyute Iraku the Sixth. And he says to Taue, hey, you should become a pro wrestler. And the reason he's able to make that kind of give that kind of advice is because he Iraku was a junior high school classmate of Jinichiro Tenryu, who of course was a main event star in All Japan Pro Wrestling. He was the number two in the company after Jumbo Tsuruta. So there's that connection he has with pro wrestling and in his friendship with Tenryu that he says to this guy, Taue, who's probably looking at him thinking, you know what? Maybe you wouldn't be, you didn't make find too much success as Zulu, but you got a good frame for pro wrestling. He probably, even back then, he probably kind of looked like Giant Baba frame-wise. And he said, Baba would love you because there's no other wrestler who looks like him, but you're the closest.
I actually find he reminds me of Jumbo in ways as well. He's kind of like the hybrid of physically of Jumbo and Baba.
I can see that. Like when Baba and Taue team together, they do complement each other very well, like aesthetically and physically. but it is kind of a contrast when he forms a team with Kawada, because he's a little bit taller than Kawada.
Absolutely.
And has a very different frame to Kawada for sure.
Yeah, for sure. And like they very much are contrasting figures, and they're kind of like a good version of Shomiz.
Oh, I don't know if I would have made that comparison, but Dave, that's why you're here to give us these references that maybe the layman fan who's more familiar with WWE but wants to get into All Japan. Oh, they're like Show Miz, the Big Show, and the Miz. I don't know, I don't know if you want to be comparing Toshiaki Kawada to the Miz. You might be getting some people angry right now, including my good friend from the Eastern Lariat, Dylan Fox. He'd be like, no, Taue, Kawada is nothing like the fucking Miz. I'm keeping myself restrained from blowing up at that comparison. So, but we'll not mention it ever again. But we'll
kind of hard hitting analysis that I came here for.
Exactly. So Tawai goes into pro wrestling. He enters the All Japan dojo in August of 1987, along with fellow trainee, new entry into the dojo, Kenta Kobashi. So right off the bat, like,
I've heard of him.
He's in a class of greatness. Like, you know, like, think about all the incredible wrestlers that have come through that dojo. Of course, you know, Masao and Kawada have already gone into the dojo, have graduated from the dojo, are wrestling. So now in 87, we've got like two new prospects, Tawai and Kenta Kobashi. Tawai with the sumo background, Kenta Kobashi with really no background. If you had listened to the Kobashi biography episode, he just kind of goes in there straight out of like school, you know. So it's I'm sure it's quite interesting to be in the dojo. So a year later, January 2nd, 1988, he makes his professional wrestling debut by teaming with the man he closely resembles physically, Giant Baba, and the promoter of the company, the owner of the company, the head booker. He's teaming with him in his debut. What an honor day for Tyler.
That must have been cloud nine for him. And who did they face?
So they defeat the team of Buddy Landel and Paul Harris, who I believe is a wrestler from the United Kingdom. And that was in Corican Hall. Like, I don't know if this is available out there in the ethernet to find. It might be, you know. That might be a
dark web kind of find, I think.
That might be dark web kind of find. Definitely. But, and you know, so I believe they win. They win that match. So great. Tawai has a win in his debut match. I don't think he necessarily got the win. I probably was Giant Baba. The next couple of years would see, you know, Tawai having a pretty typical rookie career in All Japan. Mm-hmm. You know, win a couple of matches here against probably Kobashi, lose to like people, his seniors, his senpais in the company. And then, you know, it's July 1990 that things turn around for him, because this is when the Super Generation Army of Mitsuhara Misawa, Toshiaki Kawada, Kenta Kobashi, Tsuyoshi Kikuchi, and Akira Tawai come together to form this group of youngsters in the company who are ready to take the reins of All Japan away from Jumbo Tsuruta and Tsuruta Gun, away from Jinichiro Tenryu, away from the Great Kabuki, away from Masanobu Fuchi. But, you know, it's not like he has a very like famous, like he's not well known for being in Super Generation Army.
No, and it's Japan in that era just does stables so much better than they were doing in the U.S. It's, you know, like, I don't want to make the similar showman's comparison, but they tried doing something like this with the dudes with attitudes at the same time. And we'd all rather forget that ever happened. And Super Generation Army is something that we're doing a podcast about 30 years later.
So it's, you know, you look at that lineup of the Super Generation Army, Dave, and it's Misawa who's the leader. The second is Kawada. And this is kind of based on, like, you know, seniority and position on the roster. And then number three is Kenta Kobashi. And then it's Tawai. And then it's Kikuchi, because he's the junior heavyweight. So he's always going to be the bottom of the totem pole here. But Tawai's got to be looking at this thinking, man, how am I going to get any traction in my career if I'm like number four in this group? And like, these guys are all amazing. Misawa's like going to be the future ace. Kawada's right behind him. Kobashi's like, you know, everyone can see the potential in Kobashi. And here's Tawai thinking, man, I'm screwed. I'm not going to get any traction. No one's going to notice me because I'm going to be buried in like tag matches with these guys. But, you know, like, All Japan's misfortune is Tawai's fortune, you know, because, you know, very, very soon after Super Generation Army is formed, Dave, Jinichiro Tenryu leaves All Japan Pro Wrestling. He takes quite a few wrestlers with him to form the you know, Super World Sports promotion. And like, including Jumbo Tsuruta's tag partner at the time, Yoshiaki Yatsu, one half of the Olympics with Jumbo Tsuruta. And so, like, okay, Jumbo's like, I need a new regular tag partner, especially since I'm going to be in this feud with with Misawa and his group of young upstarts.
And did they do an angle for him to turn on anybody? That really wasn't the style at the time. I think he just kind of went with them, right?
Yeah, it's you know, basically, you know, in back in the back, you know, backstage area, like, you know, behind the scenes, Baba decides to put Tawei with Jumbo as his number two in Surigun, and he just makes his debut one day with Jumbo and Masafuchi on August 18th in a six-man tag against Misawa, Kawada, and Kikuchi at Korakuen Hall. I bet it was just like they announced it probably in like on TV to announce the matches for Korakuen Hall for that date. And it was like, what? I'm sure fans were like, what? Like, Tawei's teaming with Jumbo? Oh, that's interesting. Oh, he's turned on his friends of Misawa and Kawada and Kobashi and Kikuchi. Oh, what a bastard. So he's got a lot of heat on him because, you know, in this feud between Jumbo and Misawa is like, you know, like Jumbo's kind of, you know, he's the ace of the company, but Misawa is the person with a more kind of support from the fans because he represents
momentum.
He's got momentum. He's also got, you know, he's fresh. He's like, he's the hope of like creating a new era for All Japan, which he would fulfill obviously in hindsight. But like, you know, Jumbo's like that salty veteran that people still love, but they do see him as like, you know, like, okay, Jumbo's time is past, but Jumbo's like, you know, he's not going away quietly. He's clawing. He's keeping his, you know, his hands firmly on the top spot, and you got to take him out kicking and screaming, which is basically what happens over the next 2 years with the Surigun versus Super Generation Army feud and right there with him. And I think it was a brilliant move to put Tawei with Jumbo because Jumbo needed someone of the same generation as Misawa and company to like even things out kind of in mm-hmm. terms of firepower, so to speak. But also like the thing with Tawei is that teaming with Jumbo, I think like gives him license to just be a surly bastard because not only is he teaming with Jumbo Tsuruta, who's become like this bitter old guy wanting to keep Masao away from his top spot, he's also teaming with one of the greatest heels in the history of All Japan, and that's Masanobu Fuchi.
Yeah, and he very much kept that surly demeanor throughout his All Japan years as well.
Definitely, definitely. So what are your thoughts about the team of Jumbo and Tawei?
They were just, it's kind of like the perfect mentor and student type team. You know, it's, you think about, it's really a great way to capitalize on Tawei's size. You know, you have Misawa and Kawada are kind of the pluckier underdog type body size. And then you have someone like, you know, like Don Jardine used to, the reason he was put under a mask is because he was too nice looking to be a bad guy, but he was too big to be a good guy. So they put him under the mask and his physique worked that way. And, you know, Tawei getting to be a heel really capitalizes on his strengths of being a powerhouse wrestler, being just kind of a prick. And no one was a better prick ever in wrestling, I don't think, than Grumpy Jumbo in the early 90s. So he really got to learn from the master.
And what I love about the multitude of six-man tags or straight two-on-two tags with Jumbo and Tawei is like how Tawei really becomes really good at cutting off the ring and really mm-hmm. cutting off like hope spots and cutting off like, you know, like a hot tag, like maybe some, like Kobashi will get a hot tag, but, and he'll get a couple of shots in on Tawei or whatever. And then Tawei just cuts that shit off like right away, like with one of his chops or just like grabbing like, you know, someone by the throat and just throwing them down to the ground. Not the choke slam, but just like just shoving them. Yeah. He's really good at these bully moves.
And what I really liked watching him do to link it back to sumo is when he'd do the Supari slaps, when he'd chase someone across the ring and like do the sumo slaps to their chest over and over again. That's the ultimate bringing sumo into pro wrestling style that I've ever seen.
He was really good at making that believable in the context of pro wrestling because, you know, there are some people who like will do that move of like the, you know, the forward slapping movement of sumo wrestling in pro wrestling. And sometimes it can look cheesy. You have to be really, I think, well-versed in the art of sumo as Tawei would have been and mm-hmm. some and other members of, like, you know, people who migrated from sumo wrestling into pro wrestling are good at that. So, but he was really good at that. Like the thing with Taiwei, if you look at his technique, is like he gets really squat. Even though he's taller than most of these guys, he gets squat. And so like he's able to like mm-hmm. use his power more. Like he's using his legs and his arms and his whole body to like just push around and bully like his opponents. And it's the most, you know, like compelling thing to watch in these instances is like whenever he's in the ring with Kikuchi, because of the size difference between these two. And Kikuchi at the time was one of the best like underdog baby faces in all of wrestling.
Absolutely. Like, I mean, Kikuchi, I mean, I don't know if he's an eventual biography episode for you, but he'd be a fun one to do. But watching Taui in there with all those guys was great. One of the really underrated things about Taui was how giving he was with his defense as well. I could watch him take the Tiger Driver, not the Tiger Driver 91. That's great as well. But just the plain old Tiger Driver from Misawa over and over again. Doing it on a guy that height is impressive for Misawa to be able to do, but for Taui to be able to take as well.
Oh, yeah. I mean, he's a great bumper, you know, for a man his size. And for someone who kind of moves kind of awkwardly, he's not as smooth as the other three or anyone else in the company for that matter. Like he does kind of move awkwardly, like objectively speaking, his frame is kind of awkward. His bumping is like kind of awkward, but it's his facial expressions that help like with his selling as well. Like he's good bumper, but then like the pain that he exhibits and the emotion that he exhibits in his face is just really great. Everyone talks about Kawada as being a great seller, like facials and with his amazing facials. But I'd say Taiwei is not on the same level necessarily as Kawada, but he's not far behind though. He's not far behind though. No. Yeah. But he's great. He's a great seller. And he's a great bumper. And that's something that's an important skill to have in all Japan at this time, because you're taking some hellacious bumps in this company.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, some people say they can't watch it in hindsight. I can. You know, I just forgive them for the fact that they're destroying themselves.
Oh, I have no problems watching these matches in hindsight. It's like they, you know, like I can't necessarily watch something dangerous live. Like yeah. I saw the Ibushi Naito match from Osaka live.
Oh, that's rough. Yeah.
And that bump off the apron. And like, I thought Ibushi, or I think it was Naito. I thought Naito was dead. And that, you don't ever want to feel that in person. And there's like a contingent of people on wrestling Twitter or, you know, doing podcasts thinking, who cares? It's like, okay, you can be all cool and dispassionate, but I'm sorry if I don't want to see someone die in front of me. Like,
yeah, you know? I had a Mark Briscoe moment like that. And of course it was the first show I ever took my wife to.
Lovely.
Yeah.
the fact that does she still go to shows with you is the question.
No, we grew out of trying to impress each other a while ago.
Oh, that's good. So what would you say? Give us like maybe two matches of this era of Tsurugan that you would say are great showcases for Akira Taiwei that for the listeners to go and seek out.
One thing I gotta say is that as much as Lucha gets credited for being the land of trios matches, this era of All Japan really takes six-man tag wrestling to another level. And to me, the two matches that really set that up are May 25th, 1990, where you have Misawa Kobashi and Taiwei against Tsuruta Fuchi and Kabuki. And by the way, Kabuki seems like sticks out like a sore thumb unless you go back and when you're reading that, but if you go back and watch, he was actually really good in 1990. But yeah, that match really sets off from the Misawa unmasking and shows this super generation army, you know, we're here ready to give guys like Jumbo and the gang a run for their money. It really kicks it off into full gear, leading to the eventual Misawa Jumbo match. And that's the kickstart of it, but the one that really takes it to another level is October 19th, 1990 with Jumbo, Taue, and Fuchi against Misawa, Kawada, and Kobashi.
Yes, that's a five-star match in the Wrestling Observer. It's one of my favorite matches of all time. I love that match. There's also the April 20th, 1991 match.
Just as good.
With the same six men. And of course, a year later, 1992, on May 22nd, again, Taue, Saruta, Fuchi against Misawa, Kawada, and Kobashi. Anytime like you have these three against these three, like the three in Saruta Gun and the three in Super Generation Army facing off, especially if they're in Korakuen Hall, like you can have it in other venues, but my God, it's so much better in Korakuen Hall because Korakuen Hall is a magical place. But you know what?
I'm jealous of the times you've probably gotten to be there.
I've been in Korakuen Hall probably more times than I've been to Maple Leaf Gardens. So,
wow. Yeah.
Well, I mean, I've rarely been to Maple Leaf Gardens, to be quite honest with you, maybe once for professional wrestling, but Dave, you know, like you can take out, like in the Super Generation Army side, you know, you can take one of the other guys out and put in Kikuchi, and it is pretty fucking good too. But, yeah. But the, you know, the top line of Saruta Gun is Jumbo, Fuchi, and Taue, because they are such bastards. It's wonderful to see, especially when they're in there with Kobashi, because they just beat the fucking shit out of Kobashi, and it's great.
And Kobashi probably loves every second of it in a non-kayfabe kind of way. But these matches were a part of making Kobashi as well, right?
Definitely. I mean, it's his fire that comes through, especially when he's in there with Jumbo. But definitely also when he's in there with Taue as well. But, you know, but for Taue, it's not all tag matches, you know, it's not all about his team with Jumbo. He does have some notable singles matches in this time period, is particularly against his future tag partner of Toshiaki Kawada. He has two amazing singles matches that people should go out and find, January 15th, 1991, and April 12th, 1993. And of those two, which one would you say is your favorite of their singles encounters?
You know, I could be more familiar with those, I'll be honest.
Okay, well, that's fine. There's one that's in Korakuen Hall that I think is better. And to be honest, right now, I'm blanking about which one it is. But hey, you know what? If you watch you can find both these on YouTube, and you can't go wrong with either one of them.
What I really like from that era is January 26, 91, where Misawa debuts the Tiger Driver 91 on Taue.
You know, God bless Akira Taue for being the canary in the
coal mine.
Yeah. Taking that move. Hey, I got this new move, Taue. You want to be the first recipient of it? Okay, what is it? It's like the Tiger Driver, but I don't rotate you fully onto your back. So I'm dropped on my head? Yes. Okay.
Yes, like a Pez dispenser.
Yes. Yes. I kind of want to know what, like, but you know, the crazy thing is, Dave, is like, Kawada and Kobashi see Taue take this move, and and later on, they're like, yeah, I'll take it as well.
Yeah, no, it's a special occasions type move. But like, this really puts it over. It's like the move to watch out for. And what I really like is that it wasn't a long, long match, but it was an intense one. And that ended with, it made a move.
For sure. Oh, so just to clarify about the Kawada matches. So, The January 15th, 91 match is the bloodbath match that, like, they're a super intense rivalry because this is like at the height of, like, you know, like the battles between Saruta Gun and Super Generation Army. And this kind of, this the hatred that these two exhibit in the singles match would bleed into the tag matches, and, you know, like between Jumbo and Taue against Misawa and Kawada for the tag team titles and in all these six man tags that they're having. But it's the April 12th, 93 match where Taue and Kawada shake hands afterwards, and thus is born the Holy Demon Army, because at this point in time, like, Jumbo has to leave wrestling due to his failing health. And you know, so there's a twofold problem here. Baba needs a rival for Misawa, who has ascended to become the ace of the company. He's been Triple Crown champion. So, like, Baba needs someone to, like, fill the role of Jumbo. So it's, and he picks Kawada. He's like, Kawada's going to be the rival for Misawa, you know, and it fits in perfectly, because that's the formula Baba likes to go with, because he did it with Jumbo and Tenryu before, where they were a tag team before. And then later on, Tenryu and Baba become rivals and, you know, trading wins over the various singles titles before the Triple Crown is formed, and fighting with different partners over the World Tag Team Championship in All Japan as well. So with this, he needs, you know, like, the best thing to do is basically for Kawada to take over Jumbo's stable, take over Tsurugan, but you're not going to call it Tsurugan, of course, anymore. So, like, not only does he inherit Taue as his new partner after April 12th, he also inherits Masanobu Fuchi in his corner as part of his team in the Holy Demon Army. And like, it's born, the seeds are planted on April 12th, but it's on May 14th in an awesome tag match against Kenta Kobashi and Tsuyoshi Kikuchi that you can find online, that happens at Corrigan Hall, that the Holy Demon Army make their debut. The team of Toshiaki Kawada and Akira Taue make their debut and absolutely murder Tsuyoshi Kikuchi throughout most of this match.
And that's May 14th, 1993, you said.
That is the May 14th, 1993 debut of the Holy Demon Army, one of the greatest tag teams of all time. And we're going to, and I'm going to list, like, you know, like, some of the, you know, the five-star matches that Dave Meltzer has for Taue later on in this episode. But let's talk about the Holy Demon Army and, like, what, where do you rank them in terms of, like, tag teams throughout the history of professional wrestling, Dave?
It's, you know, I mean, there's two different, the All Japan tag teams of this era are very different, because traditional tag team wrestling in North America would typically be guys who were just a tag team, whereas there they were doing what they've tried to do in later years in North America of having main event stars form tag teams, but it's never been, could never be done better than it was there. It's like, you know, it's like the best two possible heels teaming together, and they continue for so long together that it's really, it's Shakespearean watching their stuff. There's actually a really good YouTube playlist that has all the encounters between Misawa and Kobashi against Taue and Kawada. And that's what I was kind of revisiting some of the matches in the past few days and visiting some of them for the first time.
I mean, like, beyond, like, you know, the Super Generation duos of Misawa and Kobashi, and then later Misawa Akiyama. And then even after that, Misawa and Yoshinari Ogawa, you have, like, these encounters with the Holy Demon Army has with Stan Hansen and various partners that he would have, including Danny Spivey, including who else, like Johnny Ace, and then Johnny Ace teaming with, you know, Dr. Death, Steve Williams teaming with Kobashi, you know, and like, who else? We got the Miracle Violence Connection. The Miracle Violence Connection is still running around, Gordy and Williams. So running around. So, like, they, you know, they're testing their mettle, not only as like two premier singles wrestlers, but Kawada and Taue have amazing chemistry. They create, like, you know, like, you know, tag team, you know, strategies and tactics and double team maneuvers to off, you know, to, like, enhance their opposite, you know, their opposition towards, like, the baby faces that they face off. But, you know, when they're facing, like, for example, Gordy and Williams, they're the de facto baby faces, because the foreigners are always going to be the bad guys in Japan, in a Japanese company.
Especially those ones, right?
Well, especially guys who are, like, so, like, surly as Gordy and Williams are. I mean, they're super popular, but when they're facing against, like, a native Japanese team of especially of, like, two big stars, like Kawada and Taue, or, you know, Kobashi and Misawa, then they're going to be definitely the heels in that context. But yeah, there's, like, so many amazing teams and so many amazing matches. Sorry.
What's really impressive is with when you look at the series with Misawa and Kobashi, you just watch them and they just all flow together. It's like an ongoing storyline that keeps going throughout the matches. And you just feel like you're watching the best four of the best wrestlers of all time, just doing exactly what they do best.
You know, we talk about like in like the recent era of New Japan Pro Wrestling about like callbacks and people going nuts about all the callbacks, like especially with like Okada and Tanahashi. And of course, they're all there and that's a great series. But
I love that stuff. Yeah.
But the, you know, like the callbacks that you see in like a, you know, like a six, like in a 4 year period or three to 4 year period in every match that, you know, the Holy Demon Army has against Misawa and Kobashi, and then later on Misawa and Akiyama, and then Akiyama and Kobashi teaming, that's all there too. Like it rewards the longtime fan. It rewards the viewer who like, oh, they went after his left knee in that match 2 years ago, and they're going after it now, or they injured that in a 6-man tag 2 days ago in like fucking Hokkaido. Now they're after it here in Tokyo. Oh my God, this all makes sense, you know. And the great thing about Japanese wrestling is that you could follow all of this in the newspapers, in the magazines at the time. The coverage was there, so like, and they're all helping, you know, if you're especially for all following, like for example Tokyo Sports, they're all like helping, you know, play with like, you know, in enhancing kayfabe in all of wrestling at the time in the 90s in Japan. So it really helps when you have all these like details that happen in other matches that pay off in like some of the big title matches that Taue and Kawada would have for the you know All Japan World Tag Team titles. So
one of the impressive things is how interwoven it is with all the legendary singles feuds that were happening between these same guys.
Oh yeah, they're
at the same time.
Giant Baba has to be one of the greatest bookers of like, you know, keeping track of the details. And of course, I'm sure like, you know, Misawa, Kawada, Kobashi, Taue, all of them were like, yeah, remember when we did that in this match? Okay, and you hurt me. You did this to my leg, or you did this to my neck or arm. Yeah, let's work on that in this match. So that's definitely happening. But you know, Dave, let's talk about the pinnacle, the year that is most important to the career of Akira Taue, and that would be 1996. This is a great achievement. Like the things that Taue's achieves in 1996. Okay, so let's talk about them. He wins the World Tag Team Titles with Kawada. He wins the Champion Carnival by defeating Dr. Death's Steve Williams. He wins the Triple Crown by defeating Mitsuharu Misawa, a feat that his tag team partner Kawada has not yet done. He ends the legendary run that Misawa has, which is like about a 3-year run with the Triple Crown. And like people were wondering at the time who's going to beat him. People were basically thinking eventually Kawada is going to win the Triple Crown from Misawa in this reign, but no, it was as a kind of a swerve. It was Taue, and that to top things off at the end in December, him and Kawada win the Real World Tag League. So you know he wins the major tournaments, he wins all the titles in the company. So like 1996, if you want like a year to follow Taue's career, 1996 would not be a bad place to go to.
No, and it's really interesting because it's probably some of the first stuff I saw when in the 90s I ordered a tape not knowing what I was getting, and I had some vague idea what the Champions Carnival was, and on this tape it had the finals of the 96 Champions Carnival, and it's just interesting perspective, right? Because at the time I thought, oh, these poor American guys like Steve Williams will never be able to get over these Japanese guys in Japan. Now I realize in hindsight, Williams was part of making Taue, and Williams was already established at that point.
Williams is like instrumental in making Kobashi as well, in my opinion.
Yeah. And so I watched that. And then actually today I watched the match where Taue won the title from from Misawa. Misawa had actually had it for a couple months at that point. He'd had it back from Stan Hansen.
And, okay, so thanks for correcting me there.
Yeah, no, and I mean, it was kind of coming off the 19. It was very much ran into the 1992 run to 1994. And then so he wins it from Misawa in what is a shorter Triple Crown match of about 15 minutes, but it's got good intensity and it's just, you know, it's just it's a good match that puts him over. But I also watched the match where he dropped the title to Kobashi, and I loved that match. I don't know why that's not talked about as an all-time classic.
I'm sure I'll be reviewing it sometime in the future for this show.
I would hope so.
You know, like, thanks for correcting me about, like, that's not the lengthy run that he ends, but it is notable that
it's important to go over Misawa. Yeah.
That he is the one to get that important singles win for the Triple Crown over Misawa before Kawada does.
Yes. And it was Steve Williams out of the four pillars. He's the first one to win the title from Misawa.
Yes. So it's kind of a nice feather in his cap, because, like, he, you know, 1996 is like, it peaks. His career basically peaks in 96. He would always remain in the top mix in the upper mid card of All Japan. Like, but I don't think he'd ever reach, like, outside of tag matches and occasional singles matches with, like, you know, the top stars in the company, Kobashi, Misawa. Mm-hmm. He's not considered someone that's going to be like someone that Baba is going to rely on to carry the company going forward.
No, but he had, when you see that match against Kobashi, he had great presence as champion. He belonged in there as champion, and it was fantastic to watch.
I would imagine, you know, Dave, that, like, he's like, I have this title. I have the Triple Crown, which at the time was like the most prestigious title in all of wrestling, like for fans who knew, right? Like, fans who followed wrestling in Japan, in America, and in Mexico, like, this is the title. This is the work rate title. This is the belt. This is the title that means you're the best wrestler. You're the best, like, in-ring performer in all of wrestling. Not the WWF title, not the IWGP title. It's this belt. I would say it's that belt, and like the other work rate belt of the time would be the New Japan, the IWGP Junior Heavyweight title.
I'd honestly say the Triple Crown, certainly for heavyweight wrestling, might be the top title of all time.
Oh yeah, for like who's held it and
for,
like
for pure work rate type, you know, reputation.
But it is, you know, he has a steady career. And then, you know, like, you know, up until the time he leaves All Japan Pro Wrestling, along with like 90% of the roster, they leave due to the, you know, the infighting between, you know, Mitsuharu Misawa and the widow of Giant Baba who had passed away. And then, you know, he, you know, like Misawa and Motoko Baba could not get along. So Misawa says, I'm leaving. And he forms Pro Wrestling Noah in 2000. And, you know, what's an interesting note is, like, in a recent, like, talk battle that Kawada had on one of his produce shows, called, you know, Holy War, he had a talk battle. Like, that's what they call these interview segments with Tawe. And Tawe reveals in this segment that, like, hey, you know, like, I called you to see if you wanted to come to Noah. Like, it wasn't Kobashi or Misawa, because, you know, at the time, because Misawa and Kawada actually genuinely hated each other. And but, you know, Tawe said to Kawada, hey, if you want, you can join Pro Wrestling Noah. But Kawada said, no, I'm going to be here, because I think Kawada knew, like, with Misawa gone, I'm going to be the big fish in the smaller pond. Because like, there's no one left in the company, but he's still going to be the top guy in All Japan and not be second fiddle or third fiddle. Cause I think he would have been third fiddle to Kobashi in Noah. So maybe he made the best choice for his own career, but it is a big, what if, Dave, like, what if Kawada joined with, you know, accepted Tawai's offer and went to Pro Wrestling Noah in like 2000 or even 2001, that would have been interesting.
Yeah, I think the other what if is, what if Tawe had stayed?
Yeah, like, you could have, he would have, I think he would have benefited from staying. I think the company would have benefited from him staying as well.
Sure, yeah.
And
yeah.
I think he would have, like, you know, like some of the other guys might have stayed as well, because, like, you know, he has some seniority in the company. It's like, you know, it's either whoever trained under him might have stayed, right? Like, mm-hmm. it's all the trainees of both Misawa and Kobashi who really leave. Like, if Tawa, okay, so if Tawa stays and say his Kohai, the one has direct, you know, like control over training, which would be Takashi Sugiura, would be one of them. So Sugiura stays in All Japan for wrestling. That would have been interesting, you know?
For sure. And so, seeing Tawa in some matches with Tenryu during that era would have been fun too.
Oh yeah. Yeah. That would have been fun. We do see Tenryu later on in Noah in the mid 2000s, but I don't know. I can't remember, you know, if, when they had Tawa and Tenryu had interactions with one another. And, but we gotta mention that in Noah, he would achieve single success. He would win the GHC heavyweight championship. He would end the very controversial reign of Takeshi Rikyo, who was the person who defeated, mistakenly, bad choice from Masao the Booker here. Takeshi Rikyo ended Kobashi's epic title reign with the GHC title reign title, but it was Tawa who, I remember when I watched this match, Dave, like when he beats Rikyo, fucking Budokan Hall erupts, because
that was a great moment.
They are like, we don't want Rikyo to be our champion. We will take this legend who's not as great as he used to be, but we'll take him over Rikyo any day of the week. And that happens on November 5th in 2005. It's a fun match, especially the end. And I really think, you know, Tawa is like, okay, again, another chance for me to, like, just show that I am a great wrestler. And so he brought it to Rikyo in that match, and it really carries Rikyo to a pretty good, like, I'd say 3¾, 4-star match where he wins the GHC title.
Mm-hmm. And what was really cool after that as well, maybe I don't want to jump ahead, but that match was a great moment, and it's, if he hadn't already been Triple Crown champion, it would have come off like the Lifetime Achievement Award. But it was actually kind of saving the company award from Rikyo.
Yeah. Yeah. Like, you know, I think Rikyo could have, you know, it should have been Morishima in hindsight. Like, yes. It's because Rikyo was older, and he was the senpai to Morishima, but it should have been Morishima who should have ended Kobashi's reign and gone on to become, like, you know, because I think if he got the title in 2005, he would have stepped up. He would have helped Noah go to that next level in terms of with being a younger guy at the head of the company. Mm-hmm. But we're not really going to talk too much about Takeshi Morishima or Takeshi Rikyo here.
Well, what I was going to say is I really liked his title defense against Morishima. It was good fun.
Yeah, I mean, I think he just decided in that title reign, like, I'm gonna have the best, you know, time with this mm-hmm. with this title, and it's like he wins it from Rikyo, he loses it to Akiyama, right?
He does, and what I'll also note, just tying it back to something else we were talking about, on the same show, shortly before he became champion, on the same show where Rikyo defeated Misawa in a GHC title match, you also had Kobashi and Tawa teamed up against Akiyama and Tenryu. So they did cross paths there.
What a team. I always think, like, you know, like if they mix teams a little bit more in All Japan, I would love to have seen Kobashi and Tawa as a team. I think like chemistry wise, they would have worked really, really well, you know. So I would have rather seen that than like Kobashi team with Johnny Ace at that time, you know. Kawada could have teamed with, like, here's the teams, like Misawa teams with, he can be teamed with whoever, it doesn't really matter, but Akiyama and Kawada as the two surly bastards, that would be great. And then, you know, Tawa and Kobashi as like this kind of, you know, like yin yang, oil and water kind of tag team would have been awesome to have seen. But again, we're going to fantasy booking here. We're going to kind of keep it on track here.
Well, So as you mentioned, he lost the GHC title to Akiyama. And then in March of 2006, they actually had a show where it was kind of like veterans versus younger wrestlers. Interesting, kind of a reverse of the Super Generation Army. And I can't remember all the matches, but the one that I can definitely say occurred is Taue took on Naomichi Marufuji and actually put him over in what is a good, fun little match. And you could just see he was doing these windmill. Windmill. He was kind of windmilling at him with the chops, and they were just having really fun. And he really put him over. Marufuji got the wrist clutch, small package on him, and which really set up Marufuji to win the title, which I think they could have done more with. But we're not fantasy booking here.
Well, I mean, we can talk about the foibles of, you know, Mr. Hamasawa as a booker in Noah, yeah. Which, and he has a lot of them. He does. But anyways, let's stick with Taue and the positives, and you know, like other achievements he would have would be that he becomes Noah president, you know, mm-hmm. in the wake of the tragedy of Misawa's death in 2009, and you know, noted, you know, Noah historian Hisami, she basically makes a sentence that like he becomes president and he becomes an old man overnight. This job ages him because he has to manage this company that is in turmoil because they lost their president, their booker, mm-hmm. their biggest star. And yeah. And like, and it's a blow to morale in the locker room. Like Misawa was their father figure in that yeah. company, and everyone loved him. And
he had an entire locker room with PTSD, you know.
Yeah, and he died in the ring. And he tries to keep it together for as long as he can, but you know, he decides, okay, I'm retiring. I'm not going to be the president anymore. I'm also not going to be wrestling anymore. So December 7th, 2013, Taue wrestles in his retirement match where he, Morishima, Sugiura, and one of his trainees, Gemba Hiryanagi, who is kind of a funny Taue, you know, trainee, because he's one of the shortest wrestlers that you will ever see in professional wrestling.
Very much a comedy wrestler, right?
Yes, very much a comedy wrestler. And they take on the team of Tenryu, Tatsumi Fujinami, Masao Inoue, and Kentaro Shiga, with Taue pinning Inoue for the final win of his career. And you know, like, and then, you know, nowadays, you know, he opened his own steak restaurant, Dave. He went to Mitsuhiro Matsunaga. You know, he said, Matsunaga-san, like, you're having great success with your steak restaurant. Please teach me how to run my own restaurant and teach me how to make steaks for customers. And that's what Matsunaga did. And then he opened his own restaurant in Tsukuba, in the Ibaraki region of Japan. It's called Steak Izakaya Champ. And Dave, it's one of my goals. My goal, next time I'm in Japan, I'm going to go to Steak Izakaya Champ. I'm going to try to meet Taue, and I'm going to go to Kawada's ramen restaurant as well. And I'm going to meet the Holy Demon Army at their various places of business.
Yeah, definitely do that. I still have regrets over not getting to Buffalo to get to the Destroyers golf, super golf or whatever it was. So you gotta jump on the, you gotta jump while the getting's good with this kind of stuff.
Definitely. I think I still got a chance. I'm sure neither of them are going to go anywhere in the next several years. But that being said, we do have to talk about in 2018, Taue announced that he was battling stomach cancer, but he's you know, he battled through it and he got a clean bill of health because he underwent a gastric. How do you say this? Gastric. I'm terrible at saying medical procedures and stuff like that.
Gastrectomy, probably.
That's what he went. He underwent that, and then they discovered the cancer, and then he took treatment for it, and he's doing well in 2021. But
that's wonderful to hear.
Yeah. So let me just get to, like, I teased some stories about Taue, Dave, and I'm gonna get to them. I thought a lot of people would know this already, but Taue does hate training and he hates working out, and he has since his sumo days. So I think it scarred him, doing sumo training in the dojos. So
it's so intense there. Yeah.
So there's a story that, you know, Giant Baba, who wanted Tao Wei to train more, he gave him a barbell, like a singular barbell. And he said, use this at home. Just use it at home once in a while. So one day, legendary All Japan referee Kyoei Wada shows up at Tao Wei's house to hang out with him, go drink and I'm sure smoke a ton of cigarettes. And, you know, he saw the barbell and he probably knew that it was from Baba. He says, oh, have you been using that, Tao Wei? And Tao Wei says, oh, every day. I'm using it every day, like at least for an hour. And then Tao Wei's young son at the time comes into the room and says, Dad, I've never seen you pick this up once.
That's funny.
So he double crossed his dad and revealed to Kyoei Wada, who I'm sure reported back to Baba, Baba-san, Tao Wei does not use that barbell. That singular barbell that you gave him to use at home, he does not use it. His son confirmed it, which I'm sure didn't surprise Giant Baba. But the other funny story, Dave, is that, you know, Giant Baba arranged a training session down at the beach. So, you know, and there's a famous photo out there of the four pillars holding up this like of this tree trunk on the beach they're like in their running shorts and everything like that. But Tao Wei, you know, comes to the beach, he's wearing sandals, and Baba says to him, hey, where are your trainers? Where are your sneakers? You know, where are your running shoes? And Tao is like, who wears what? What? We're training at the beach? The beach is for, like, you know, swimming and and just lying about and drinking beer. And, like, you know, Misawa's got his runners on. Kobashi's got his runners on. Kikuchi's got his runners on. And Kawada's got his runners on. But there's Tao Wei just wearing sandals. And, you know, he said famously to Baba, hey, seaside is for sandals, not trainers. So that epitomizes the man that hates training, but is amazing at doing so many athletic things in his career. The master of the dynamic kick, the dynamic suplex, the dynamic bomb, the Nodo Toshi suplex, the Origawa Tao Wei. Like, just these incredible moves. Of his moveset, Dave, which one is your favorite?
Choke slam to the floor. You can't beat that. It just looks so cool every time.
Yes, the famous apron Nodoa Otoshi that has nearly, I'm sure, like nearly killed many a wrestler. But you know what? The good thing about Tao Wei's choke slam, the Nodoa Otoshi, is that unlike, like, you know, say like the Undertaker's choke slam or the Big Show's choke slam or Kane's choke slam, he doesn't pick some, like, those guys pick people up and throw them to the ground. Basically, he picks someone up and then he's he's driving them into the ground basically with a choke. Yeah. Everyone says like Undertaker's choke slam is so safe. He takes care of you. That's awesome. But, like, hey, you know, like, there's something to be said for appreciating a good, like, I'm just going to drive you as hard as I can into that mat. Cause, like, he didn't kill anyone with that move. So it's okay.
No, but it was in the Kobashi title loss that it really looked cool. Like, they were just fighting so hard for it on the apron. And the fans were popping so huge. Yeah, I know you mentioned like he doesn't have as fancy a moves as the other guys, but that's what I really remember from watching my first tapes of All Japan, is that choke slam to the floor. And I love him for it.
I love his front kick, the dynamic kick. Like, he gets some amazing height on that thing and just really shows off like how actually athletic he is. And I'm a huge fan of the dynamic bomb, which is his version of a sit out power bomb. And it just looks so amazing when he is able to hit it, especially on someone like, you know, Kenta Kobashi. So yeah, like other things, like I can talk about with Akira Tao Wei, that his hobbies include fishing. He's a big fan of riding motorcycles. And in recent years, he's become a big fan of watching Korean dramas.
Really?
Yes. It's something he quite enjoys in his later years. So there you go. Like, if you think, man, I wish I knew a great wrestler who likes watching Korean dramas like me, then Akira Tao Wei is the wrestler for you. You should go watch all his matches from the 90s and 2000s and just think, like, in 2021, he's a big fan of watching Korean dramas. Like, if you're the same way, there you go. You found a kindred spirit in Akira Taue.
Yeah, that's not my point of connection, but I am lazy and I hate working out, so he's my guy.
There you go. There you go. All right, let's talk about his championships and accomplishments, as well as giving kind of a recommendation for like high rated matches from Akira Taue's career. So in All Japan Pro Wrestling, he has won the All Asia Tag Team Championship one time with Shinichi Nakano. They defeated the team of Davey Boy Smith and Johnny Smith for that title. He's been the Triple Crown champion one time, defeating Mitsuharu Misawa on May 24th, 1996. And he would lose the title to Kenta Kobashi on July 24th in 1996 as well. So not a very long title reign. He's won the World Tag Team Championship seven times, once with Jumbo Tsuruta, and six times with Toshiaki Kawada. He's won the Champion Carnival in 1996. He defeated Steve Williams in the finals on April 20th, 1996. He's won the world, the Real World Tag League, or the World's Strongest Tag Team Determination League, whichever name you prefer for that tournament. He's won it twice in 1996 and 1997 with Toshiaki Kawada both times. And both times, they defeated the team of Mitsuharu Misawa and Jun Akiyama. And he won the January 2nd Corken Hall Heavyweight Battle Royal, which in 1992, which I'm sure no one cares about, really. And he's won the World Tag Team Championship Tournament in 2000 with Toshiaki Kawada, which I'm sure was like the last major accomplishment they had as a team. In Pro Wrestling NOAH, he was the GHC Heavyweight Championship one time. And he, of course, defeated Takeshi Rikyo, which we mentioned, on November 5th, 2005. He would lose that title to Jun Akiyama on January 22nd, 2006. In 2005, probably because of this championship win, he won the Nikan Sports Fighting Spirit Award. In Tokyo Sports, he's won the Fighting Spirit Award in 1992 and 1996, obviously as a reward for like the amazing year he had in All Japan at that time. He's won the Tokyo Sports Lifetime Achievement Award in 2014. He won Match of the Year in front of Tokyo Sports in 1995 with Toshiaki Kawada versus Mitsuharu Misawa and Kenta Kobashi in the famous 6-9-95 tag match that I will review in June of 2022. So that review is coming up later on in next year, and I have a special guest for that particular show already, Dave. I've already picked, and I've already talked to the person, and they said, sure, I'll come on that show and talk about that. Taue is joining me to talk about that match. You know what? You're gonna have to listen to find out, Dave. You and all the other listeners. So, also for Tokyo Sports, he won Tag Team of the Year in 1997 with Toshiaki Kawada. Let's go to the Wrestling Observer Newsletter Awards, and we're gonna talk about all the 5-star matches he's had. So, 1990, 1991, 1992, October 19th, April 20th, May 22nd. These are all. May 22nd, these are all the 6-man tag team matches with Tsuruta Gun versus the Super Generation Army. You can't go wrong with any of these matches. 1993, July 2nd, with Toshiaki Kawada and Yoshinari Egawa taking on Misawa, Kobashi, and Akiyama in a 6-man tag. 1993, December 3rd, 93, with Kawada taking on Misawa and Kobashi, probably in the Real World Tag League.
Great match.
February 13th, 1994, with Toshiaki Kawada versus and Masanobu Fuji taking on Misawa, Kobashi, and Giant Baba in a 6-man tag. May 21st, 1994, with Toshiaki Kawada taking on Misawa and Kobashi. January 24th, 1995, with Kawada against Misawa and Kobashi. 1995, in a singles match against Mitsuharu Misawa on April 15th. And June 30th, 1995, with Taman Honda and Toshiaki Kawada taking on Misawa, Kobashi, and Satoru Asako in a 6-man tag. May 23rd, 1996, with Kawada against Misawa and Jun Akiyama. December 6th, 1996, with Kawada against Misawa and Akiyama. And December 5th, 1997, with Kawada against Misawa and Jun Akiyama. So I would say like they have as many memorable matches with Misawa and Akiyama as they do against Misawa and Kobashi, Dave.
Yeah, it's especially that last run there. My friend Dylan Hales, who I mentioned earlier, actually calls the December 6, 96 match. He thinks it's the best match of all time.
Well, there you go.
Yeah,
Dylan Hales is someone you should listen to.
A lot of wrestling.
Yeah, Dylan Hales is definitely someone you should listen to when it comes to, you know, what's a great professional wrestling match. And just to close things off here, Dave, we're just gonna go through the top 10 Akira Taue matches listed on Cage Match, and this is by order of rating. So at 9.81, it's the Holy Demon Army versus Kobashi and Misawa from 6/9/95. At 9.71, May 21st, 1994, the Holy Demon Army versus Kobashi and Misawa. At 9.65, April 20th, 1991, Tsuruta Gun versus Super Generation Army. At 9.61, what is it here? December 3rd, 93. Holy Demon Army versus Kobashi and Misawa. At 9.59, at number five is December 6, 1996, Holy Demon Army versus Akiyama and Misawa, the match you just talked about. At 9.56, at number six is Holy Demon Army versus Kobashi and Misawa from June 1st, 1993. At 9.56, at number seven is April 15th, 1995, Taue versus Misawa in a singles match. At 9.47, October 19th, 1990, Taue Jumbo Mifuchi versus the Super Generation Army, which we talked about before. And at 9.34, at number nine is the Holy Demon Army versus Kobashi and Misawa on January 24th, 1995. And finally, at number 10, at the rating of 9.28, it is a six-man tag, Tsuruta Gun versus the Super Generation Army from May 22nd, 1992. And you can't go wrong with any of these matches. And yeah, I mean, if you want a guide to, like, not only some amazing Taue matches, Dave, but just some of the greatest tag matches and singles matches in the history of professional wrestling, but mainly tag matches, then, you know, Check out any of the matches that I just mentioned there.
And did you want to do a top five for each other as well of our matches?
I didn't make a top five, but you tell me your top five. I'm going to go basically with the ones on Cage Match. They kind of pretty much line up with my feelings for Taue. I'll include the two Kawada matches and the match against Misawa, and where he wins the title, and the one where he loses the title, Kobashi, and the Champion Carnival final with Steve Williams. Those are matches you cannot go wrong as far as singles matches go.
So I've got a top six, with number six being December 6, 96, with teaming with Kawada against Misawa and Akiyama. Number five, I have April 15th, 95, a singles match in the Champions Carnival final against Misawa. Fantastic match that really, although it was a loss, really probably was part of elevating Taue to the level, being ready for 1996. December 3rd, 93, teaming with Kawada against Misawa and Kobashi. May 21st, 94, with Misawa and Kobashi against Kawada and Taue. One that might be controversial to some people, hopefully they're not too hung up on what I'm saying, is number two. I have July 24th, 96, the title loss to Kobashi. And yeah, I mean, it's pretty hard to go wrong with 6/9/95.
It is hard to go with what many people do consider to be the greatest tag match in the history of all of professional wrestling there, Dave. But that's it. That's our look at Akira Taue. I hope people have learned something about Dynamic T. I hope people have come away with an appreciation for Akira Taue that you and I share. And I know a lot of people that I know share for Taue, and including our mutual friend, Alan Farrell. I know he's a big fan of Akira Taue, and he's looking forward to listening to this show. But yeah, any final thoughts about Taue here?
Oh, I just want to say hi to Alan. And yeah, just again, the Ringo Starr of the group, although I would say there's no distance between him and the other three, like there might be with Ringo. I'm a Ringo fan. But, you know, it's like with Ringo, you got to appreciate him for himself. And the same is with Taue. He had a perfect career just as far as the length goes. He stepped away at the right time from the ring. The business would not be the same without him. And probably one of the better big man wrestlers you're going to see, especially out of Japan.
Definitely, definitely. And Dave, thank you so much for joining me on this look back at the career, the life of Akira Taue, including his disdain for training and using barbells.
Thank you for having me.
Yeah. And if people want to find out anything else you're doing with regards to wrestling content, where can they find you?
You can usually find me on Facebook. People will ask me to get some podcasts going, and I really think this got the itch going again. I think I'm going to try and get something going on.
That's awesome to hear. I thank you for coming on to do this show with me. And of course, you can find me at WHPark9 on Twitter, and you can find this show, The Long and Winding Royal Road, at postwrestling.com, along with most of my other content. Like, I am, of course, on Post Perez with John Pollock usually every month, and then I do the MCU Later show with Wei Ting every Thursday night at Post Wrestling behind the Post Wrestling Cafe Patreon. So please, subscribe to that to be able to listen to me and Wei and usually a guest talk about what's been happening on the MCU shows on Disney Plus. It's always a fun show to do. And from what people tell me, it's a fun show to listen to, Dave. But also, if you like this show, if you are a big fan of the Four Pillars, then you should go to store.postwrestling.com and pick up the Long and Winding Railroad t-shirt that has been endorsed by Alan Farrell, has been endorsed by Rich Fan over the Pro Wrestling Torch, has been endorsed by many a person that I'm forgetting about right now, but also endorsed by Dustin Meyer, who placed an order with us and got the white version of the Long and Winding Royal Road Pillars t-shirt that you can find at the Post Wrestling Store. Go check it out. It comes in black, it comes in white, different sizes, and look as cool as myself. I'm currently wearing it right now, Dave.
I'm currently looking it up.
Are you looking it up? It's a good shirt, So
it has the four pillars on it.
It does. Cartoon version of them.
It shall be mine.
There you go. So I'm going to be saying Dave Musgrave's name on a future episode of the Long and Winding Royal Road as a purchaser of the t-shirt, just like I did with Dustin Meyer. Dustin Meyer, thank you so much for placing the order, for getting the shirt, and for being a listener to this show. And on behalf of Dave, I want to thank all listeners for sticking with us and listening to us talk about Akira Taue. And until next time, I will say goodbye and see you later.